Hare Krishna. So today we are assembled on this extremely auspicious day of the appearance of Lord Ram. And I will speak on the topic of how Lord Ram exemplifies facing adversity with dignity. How we can go through difficulties in life without giving in to them, without giving up or giving in. So broadly, I'll speak this in three parts. I'll talk about one incident from Lord Ram's life. We will discuss some analysis and application. And then we'll talk concludingly how bhakti can help us to analyze, apply these principles better. Now, every world tradition has some stories which are considered sacred. And the idea is that these sacred stories are like a mental home for people. All of us, we have a physical home where we go to whenever we are in trouble, or rather when we are tired, when we are exhausted, that's where we want to go to. So just as we have a physical home, we need an inner home where our consciousness can rest. In fact, Prabhupada also points to this when he's talking about the great devotees. The Bhagavad-Gita has four verses which are considered its Chatur Shloki Gita. Does anyone know which are those? 10 point?
10, 8, 10, 9, 10, 10, and 10, 11.
Excellent. Thank you. You get 10 out of 10. Good. So now, in 10.9, Krishna uses the word Machitta Sarva Durga. Sorry, Machitta Madgata Prana Bodhayanta Parasparam Kathayanta Shyamam Nityam Dushyanti Charamanti Cha. So Krishna says, Machitta. Now we could translate this simply as the consciousness is fixed on me. But Prabhupada translates it so insightfully. Prabhupada's purports, we can say, are pregnant with wisdom. There is wisdom over there, and as we contemplate on it, then we see there's so much wisdom. He writes there as, their thoughts reside in me, their thoughts dwell in me. So a devotee doesn't just think of Krishna. For a devotee, Krishna is the home for the thoughts, for the consciousness. And normally what do? When we go to home, that's a place where we are comfortable. That's where we get rest, we get energy, we get love. That's the place where we go to be rejuvenated from the world's struggles. And what applies to our body also applies to our consciousness. So the Lord's pastimes are meant to be like our inner home. And when we dwell on these pastimes, we can get rejuvenated by that. And in fact, when the Lord descends to the world, there are multiple purposes. One purpose is contextual and one purpose is eternal. The contextual purpose is that he descends to destroy adharma at that time and establish dharma. And Krishna talks about this in 4.7 and 8. These are the verses which are often quoted about the Lord's descent. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutthanam dharmasya tadatmanam srujamyaham paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. So Krishna comes to establish dharma, to empower those who are supporting dharma and to disempower those who are opposing dharma. And that's what he did as Ram also. But along with that, there is a timeless dharma. Because the world is such a place, even if dharma is established, by the power of time, things will change. Everything will change. See, if you keep just milk like that, the milk will get spoiled. But if you want to make milk into butter, then you have to follow a particular process. You have to handle the milk carefully. The milk will not become butter automatically. So by the power of time, change will inevitably happen. But that change will be destructive, not constructive. So constructive change requires effort. And that is something which Krishna leaves as a legacy for all times. And that's what he points to in the next verse, where he says, Janma karma cha me divyam evam yo vetti tatvatah tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mameti so arjuna. He says the timeless purpose of his descent is to reveal his pastimes. By meditating on them, by understanding them, by becoming absorbed in them, we become elevated. Our heart becomes attracted, and then ultimately we attain him. Krishna uses the word tattvataha. We need to understand the philosophy. Without the tattva, without the philosophy, Krishna's pastimes are amusing. Or Ram's pastimes are also amusing. Oh, there was a demon who abducted a woman and he went and killed and got back his queen. It's amusing. It's entertaining. But with the philosophy, Krishna's pastimes become amazing. Not amusing, but amazing. God himself descends to this world and he does astonishing things. So, this is a timeless purpose. And how is this timeless purpose served? That is, when through the pastimes, we become attracted to him. And God has two primary aspects. One is his greatness and the other is his sweetness. So, we need to understand his greatness so that we develop some submission to him. And simultaneously, we need to understand his sweetness so that we can develop affection. And submission and affection together lead to strong devotion. If there's only affection without submission, that is devotion but is sentimental. If there is only submission but no affection, then that is more like a boss-employee kind of relationship. There's no personal connect over there. So we need to appreciate both the Lord's greatness and the Lord's sweetness. Then there is devotion, that is transformation. That is a combination of great affection and submission. So today's, with this background, I'll focus on the sweetness of Ram Leela as is revealed in one particular pastime. And to understand his sweetness, we'll focus not so much on his greatness. Although we understand his greatness, but his greatness is not his omnipotence. His greatness is in his character. So Ram was young, virtuous, and powerful. And sometimes, you know, there are some small children. And some children are so good, They are just like primed for success. They are talented, they are dedicated, they are courteous. Everything that is good for them, for making it big in life, it is there. So Ram was like that, as a young boy, as a teenager. And then he went with Vishwamitra and he felled great demons who were terrorizing the area. He was heroic also. And then he won the hand of Sita. So there is a beautiful Nam Ramayana, which is 108 names of Ram, that describes one pastime of Ram. So we will recite some. I'll just mention that name and then you can try to follow it so that we'll contemplate on Ram. So this describes how Lord Ram won the hand of Sita. So it says Trambaka Karmuka Bhanjak Rama. So Trambak is Lord Shiva, Karmuk is his bow, Bhanjak. So he had to pick up the bow, but he didn't just pick it up, he broke it. He just broke it. So in today's terms, if you want to talk, suppose somebody is say playing a cricket match and they have a last ball, they have to hit the sixer. And they not only hit a sixer, but the ball breaks the wall of the stadium and goes out. It's out of the scope itself. So Ram was lifted to lift up the bow and string the bow. And nobody else was able to do it. But what did he do? He didn't just lift and string the bow. He tied the string with such strength that the bow broke. And so they celebrated for that. Trambaka Karmuka Bhanjak Rama. Trambaka Karmuka Bhanjak Rama. And then what happened? Sita came to him. Dashrath signaled to her that he is indeed undisputed champion. So sometimes there's a close competition. Say somebody gets 90 points, somebody gets 91 points or 92 points. But here, like everybody else was 5 points, he was 500 points. There's no class only. There's no competition itself. So Sita Arpita Varmalik Rama. Sita Arpita Varmalik Rama. So she offered the garland. The garland indicated the marriage. So basically Ram's life was following a perfect trajectory. He overcame demons, he won a beautiful princess, and then he came back to his kingdom and he was going to become the prince regent and the king. So normally, the more life goes the way we want it to, the more we dream it to, then what happens? When it doesn't go the way we want, it becomes very difficult to accept it. So many times when we face problems, it is how unexpected or expected the problems are that determines our response. So if we know that, say yesterday evening we had a program, many of you came for the program, so there's a storm. So we know we have to go slowly, weather forecast also storm is there, so we go cautiously. But suddenly out of the blue something comes up, that it's a little more difficult to deal with it. So Ram was going to be coronated as the prince regent, and that night a sudden conspiracy happened. And when he went to his father's place, he was told by his stepmother Kaikai, you are exiled. You have to go to the forest for 15 years. And Bharat will become the prince regent. Actually, exile is an extremely brutal punishment. It's only one level below the worst punishment. That is execution. When you are executed, your life is taken away. When you are exiled, everything except your life is taken away. Everything, your wealth, your friends, your social circle, your possessions, your prestige, everything is taken away. You know, to get some small idea of what it is like, many of you are, say, Indians who might be an H1B visa. So if, so if your visa is not extended, then suddenly I have to leave the country. Now, I have a job over here, I have a home, I have a family, I have a life over here. Suddenly I have to go. But for us, actually, at least we have a home in India, we have relatives, we can build a life over there. But for Ram, it was just one moment, everything. Just leave and go. And there is no fault of his at all. Generally, even if we are faulty, we don't want to admit our fault. It is said that success has many parents and failure is always born an orphan. When something wrong happens, nobody wants to take responsibility for it. Who did that? Oh, they. So like that, even when we have a fault, we don't want to admit it. But if there is no fault at all, and then even a small wrong happens, it's difficult to bear with. But when such a catastrophic wrong happens, everything is taken away. How does one deal with it at that time? So, Ram exemplifies this. The Ramayana begins with the question which is asked by Valmiki Muni to Narada Muni. What are the characteristics of an ideal person? Who is an ideal person? And a list of characteristics are described, and thereafter it is said that Ram is such a person who demonstrates the ideal characteristics. Generally, when something bad happens to us, a normal human tendency is to feel sorry for oneself. And it's understandable, you know, why did this bad thing happen to me? But sometimes self-consciousness, that means just thinking about oneself, self-consciousness is like a black hole. And the more we think about ourselves, the more we feel sorry for ourselves, and just our spirits start becoming darker and darker and darker. That's how resentment grows. Now, first we become resentful of this person, then we become resentful of other people, then we become resentful of the whole world. And there is this tendency nowadays, many people feel that I am a victim. And it's not just a matter of feeling, it's true. We may have been victimized. Because, you know, we live in a world which is a difficult place. And everybody has snakes inside them. We are all human beings. But essentially, you could say we are human beings, but all has other snake-like weaknesses within us, snake-like desires within us. And sometimes those snakes just pop out and bite. Some person who seems to be a very nice person, suddenly they start behaving so terribly. And why is this person doing like this? So it's like, what has happened is, some snake inside them has come out and it's biting us. So that's what happened to Kaikeyi. So all of us, we might externally look like civilized human beings, but in spite of that, these snakes are still there. And we try to control those snakes as much as possible, but sometimes just come out. And then the magnitude of the biting, the magnitude of the wounding, the magnitude of the poisoning that can happen, nobody can know that, how much it will be. So when this happens, Ram, how does he respond? It's extraordinary. He says, actually, that he has gone to the Dashrath's palace, and Dashrath and Kaikeyi are there, and he can see that there is a clear tension between them, two of them. Sometimes the two people, just by the way they look at each other, you can make out whether they are affectionate or they are antagonistic. Sometimes people go to great efforts to not look at someone. You know, they talk with that person, they look everywhere as if that person doesn't exist and talk with them. So just attachment, we constantly look at a person. Aversion means we constantly endeavor to not look at that person. So when there is tension between two people, it's like easily palpable. Sometimes you go into a room also, and it is like walking into a minefield. Is it one step wrong and one minefield will explode. Another step wrong, the other minefield explodes. So you just caught in between them. So Ram could sense that there was tension between the two. And he could see that his father was in great distress. And Dashrath also was aware of what a terrible, atrocious wrong was being done to Ram, but he couldn't stop it because he was obligated to honor his word. And he actually never spoke those words that you have to go to the forest. It was Kaikeyi who spoke this. The king, in order to honor his word to me, has told you go to the forest for 14 years. And when Ram saw this, as I said, when we think of our problems, we just sink into that black hole. But if you think about others, see, when we are in distress, it is not just we who are in distress. It is people around us are also in distress. If they have some concern for us, even if they have some affection for us, or even if they have some connection to some obligation for towards us or through us. So if we fall sick, say if we get a fracture or we get some disease, now if we are in the hospital, we are miserable. Naturally, it's painful. But some people, when they are sick, life has made them sick and miserable, but they make it their life to make others miserable. Isn't it? They complain, they nag, they yell, and then nobody wants to be with such a person. So yes, we cannot change the fact that we are sick, but we can make sure, we can at least behave in a way that we don't make others sick. Of course, one level is we don't make them sick by infecting them with our disease. But we can make others sick of us. If a person is constantly complaining, blaming, sometimes we feel life is so unfair. I am so helpless. Sometimes we may feel that this situation is so terrible, I'm helpless, I can't do anything, I'm powerless. Has any of you ever been in such a situation when you felt you were powerless? Yes. Yeah. So now, when we are in such a situation, when you feel I'm powerless, you can ask ourselves this question. Can I make things worse? What a question, you know. Who will want to make things worse? Things are bad enough already. Yeah, we are not talking about actually making things worse. We are investigating the possibility. Say if I got a fracture in one foot of my mind and I am bedridden because of that. Now can I make things worse? Yes. I can take a hammer and crack my other knee also. So, no matter how bad things are, we can always make them worse. Now, the point is not that we should make them worse. The point is to recognize that we are not as powerless as we think. If I can make things worse, that means I can make them better also. It's a counterintuitive thought, but if I can make things worse, I can make them better also. And one way to make them better is to stop thinking about our own problems. So Ram's first thought is not that how dare I be exiled like this. He recognizes that there's tension between Kaikai and Dasharath. So his first thought is how to decrease the temperature, how to decrease the tension. And he says, oh Mother Kaikai, I always thought of you like my own mother, not different from my mother Kaushalya. And I also thought that you treated me like your own son, just like Bharat. But today it causes me great sadness to see that you never accepted me as your son. Now when he says this, she was probably preparing for attack against her. How could your own son you send away to a forest like this? But then Ram says, if you had truly accepted me as your son, then for such a small thing as a kingdom, you wouldn't even needed to trouble my father. You could just have come to me and told me, and I would have given the kingdom to Bharat happily. Now, this is not what Kaikeyi is expecting to hear. Generally, what happens? Usually, whenever we have to hurt someone, before hurting them, we have to depersonalize them. Depersonalize them means that we have to think that this person is not a good person. Or worse, this person is not a person only. So, whenever terrorists kill some people, they don't think of the other people as human beings. They think of other people just as agents of evil we have to remove. So when we have to hurt someone, to some extent we have to depersonalize them. But here what Ram is doing is, Ram is just taking the wind out of her attack. She's thinking, I have to defend myself. I will readily give the kingdom. So by this, he's trying to decrease her hostility towards him and her hostility towards her husband. Because if Ram also opposes, if Ram resents, Ram rebels, then Dasharath will be further torn. So what does Ram do? Just takes it gracefully. And then he turns to his father. He says, Father, please do not grieve. He says, it is my privilege to ensure that your word of honor is protected. I will immediately prepare and go to the forest. Please have Bharat called and let him be enthroned as the prince regent. And he offers his respects to both Kaikeyi and Dasharath and departs. Kaikeyi is stunned by this turn of events. She is expecting a fight, but Ram doesn't fight at all. And normally, there are no secrets in the world. Most people, when they tell you, can you keep a secret? That means they are not able to keep the secret. Isn't it? When they can't keep a secret, they tell others to keep a secret. So, especially anything that happens in a royal palace, there are always attendants who are hearing. They just want to get the lead. And when this is such a devastatingly sensational news, so immediately the news starts spreading. And Lakshman comes to know about it. Now Sita and Kaushalya, they are in their own prayer rooms, they are praying for Ram. They don't come to know. Lakshman comes to know. Lakshman is furious. Lakshman is like an angry young man. he is he says, how dare such atrocity happen? He says, what fault have you ever committed? He says, how can the kingdom be seized from you and you be sent to the forest? See, when we are angry, usually we need someone to blame. It's fine to blame destiny, but what do you do with destiny, isn't it? Whom do you blame? Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur gives the example that like trying to blame God or blame destiny is like spitting at the sky.
All that happens is the spit comes back on our own face. So, we usually need someone here and now to blame.
So, Lakshman first gets angry with Dashrath. And he says that the king, he's so angry that he doesn't even refer to Dashrath as his father. He says the king is maddened by lust. Lust for his youngest wife. And there is these three queens, and this so the scriptures often talk about polygamy. But almost every instance of polygamy is accompanied with big problems. Almost everywhere. So what happens is, so there is Kaikeyi is the youngest queen, but she is the one whom Dashrath gives the maximum attention. So anyway, there is already a tension among them. And then he says he's maddened by lust. That's why, you know, he is favoring her son in such a blatantly partial way. So Ram is very grave. He says, he's our father. And I was with him. He said, he's not doing this out of infatuation. He's doing this out of obligation. It gave him no pleasure. I could see how much pain he was in. He says, what obligation? He says, he had promised Kaikeyi that he will give her two moons. So generally, when we have arrived at some conclusion, it's like whatever evidence is against that conclusion, it's like, I have already made up my mind, don't confuse me with the facts.
So, some people are like that.
So, Lakshman says, now, what is this boon? I think it's just a story. We never heard of these two boons. So, he said, no, why would, you know, our father is an honorable person. Why would he make a story like this? And then, Lakshman says, oh, this Kaikeyi, she's so selfish. So now his anger shifts from Dashrath to Kaikeyi. This Kaikeyi is so selfish. How can she always treated you as with such affection and now she's become so brutal? So he says that Ram says, don't speak harshly about her. You know how much she loved me. He says, her love for me was just like Kaushalya's love for me. So it was like the flow of the Ganga. Lakshman is still angry. He says, that's what I can't understand. How did the Ganga dry up in one night? And then Ram says, that's why. When I saw her disposition, so completely different from a normal disposition, I understood that this must be the working of destiny. And this is the work of destiny. Now, this is a very interesting reasoning. See, generally, we try to look for a cause-effect connection in things. Say, if your child comes back from school with a black eye, hey, what happened? It's, no, I turned black.
What do you mean I turned black? It can't turn.
What happened? Something must have happened. Did you find it somewhere? No. So normally we look for a cause of a connection. So if the child has not had a fight, then you got some infection. Somebody says, where did you get that infection? What kind of infection causes a black eye like this? So normally we look for a cause. Whenever we see an effect, we look for a cause. And And usually, we look for immediately understandable causes. Just like if somebody, say, on a cold night, say, eats 10 ice creams. 1, 2, 3, 10 ice creams. Enjoy it. But the next morning, ice cream! It's terrible. Now, if they have got a terrible throat the next morning, is that because of their past karma? Yes, past night's karma. So generally, when we see an effect, we try to find a cause for that effect. And we try to look for some immediate causes. But sometimes, when no immediate cause seems to be there, then we have two options. One is, everything happens by chance and I was just unlucky. And this is the materialistic way of looking at things. But and people say that, oh, there is no cause effect in the world, atheistic, materialistic, people may say like that. But nobody lives like that. Even atheists, when they are raising their children, will they tell their child, whether you study or don't study, it's not going to make any difference. Everything happens by chance. No. Whether you clean your bed or not clean your bed, whether how the bed will be by chance. Nobody lives that way, isn't it? So even if something, we can't make sense of why it is happening. We don't lose faith in the cause-effect correlation. Say for example, somebody say, we go to a doctor and we have some, say, small swelling on the body. The doctor says, you've got cancer. What? He first asks, what caused the cancer? Now, cancer is one disease which is very difficult to pinpoint the cause in general. But then, once we go beyond the denial, we accept it. What is the next thing? Okay, is it treatable? What is the treatment? So when we are asking what is the treatment, that means that we have not lost faith in the cause-effect connection. That this effect, why the cancer came, I don't know. But still, okay, what can I do by which the cancer's effect can be mitigated, can be eliminated? So we may not be able to make sense of one cause-effect connection particularly, but that doesn't mean we lose faith in the cause-effect connection itself. We still always have that faith. So what the scriptures tell us is, that when the immediate cause-effect connection doesn't make sense, that is where we consider destiny. Destiny is basically something which is like an accumulation of our own past karma coming upon us now. So destiny, its purpose is to help us make sense of those things which don't make sense. To make sense of those things which don't make sense. So normally people would behave with us based on our reciprocation. If we are kind to them, they are kind to us. But if somebody who has been kind to us suddenly turns cruel, why is this? We try to figure out, did I do anything to offend a person? But sometimes we may have done nothing to offend the person. Of course, we can't say I never offended them. But we always, in the course of life, we all offend each other. But nothing. Sometimes the action of the person will be completely out of proportion to whatever wrong we may have done. So at that time, you can see that this is destiny. That is how we can gain some acceptance and move on. Now here, Lakshman is still angry. He says, destiny? He says, only cowards consider injustice to be destiny and accept it. He says, heroes fight against injustice. He says, this is not destiny. This is injustice. You fight against it. And then Ram says, this is my considering. And Lakshman is so angry. He says, we should fight against this. We should rise in rebellion against our father and I will make you the king. And he says, if anybody stops you from becoming the king, they will have to face my arrows. And Ram becomes very grave. And he says, oh Lakshman, your first arrow will have to be shot at me. He says, Lakshman is angry.
But Ram completely deflates him over here. So he wants to fight for Ram, not fight against Ram. Isn't it? So then Ram says, for me, the most important consideration is, what is my duty? As a son, service to my father, I was ready to ascend the throne. Now as a son, in service to my father, I'll go to the forest. So throughout, Ram, what is he doing? He's not trying to collect sympathy and make people feel sorry for him. He's actually trying to decrease the temperature. Why? So that things can move on. And there are different ways in which we can understand who is a great person. One definition of greatness is that such person works very hard and makes life bend to their will. This is what I want to do and this is what I will do, no matter what goes wrong. That's one parameter for understanding greatness. The people who are super achievers, that's greatness, that's true. But there's another much more important parameter of greatness. And that is not just making life say yes to us, but accepting when life says no to us. Because sooner or later, life will say no to every one of us. And what do we do at that time? So either we can keep resenting, or we can start recalibrating. Either we can be resenting, or we can start recalibrating. Recalibrating means, okay, what is the best way forward over here? So suppose, say, we have learned rowing, or we plan to learn rowing. Does anyone know rowing over here? Okay, good. Missy, what is there to learn in rowing? You know, just move the row. And everything seems easy till we actually do it. So when you start rowing, somebody will plan, I want to row, and I want to row very smoothly, elegantly. I'll move my arms gracefully and the boat will move swiftly. And everybody will click photos and put them on Facebook. And everybody will appreciate what an expert rower I am. Somebody plans like that and they call their friends to have their exhibition in rowing. And when their exhibition is about to start, suddenly a monster wave comes from nowhere. And that monster wave just knocks. And now there is no boat under them, there are no oars in their hands. And still they are playing their mental movie. They're still rowing. All that will happen is they'll sink. They'll drown. So now, if the reality has changed so drastically, then what do? You have to recalibrate. Okay, what do I do now? Let me paddle, let me swim, let me get to the coast first. Isn't it? So like that, say if we are here, reality is here, and our expectations are in between. Our expectations help us to shape reality positively. Okay, I want to build this kind of house. I want to have this kind of career. I want to have this kind of family. So many things we plan. Even in our service, we may plan. No, I want to make a dress for the deities like this. I want to be able to speak like this. I want to be able to sing like this. Whatever. So we are here. The reality is here. Our expectations are here. And our expectations can help us to shape reality. But sometimes things change in such a way that what happens is we are here, the reality is here, and the expectations have gone here. That means it's a complete mismatch. So if we keep thinking about the expectations, oh, I want it to be like this, I want to be like this. Basically, the expectations then start coming in the way of dealing with reality. Sometimes expectations can help us to deal with reality. And sometimes expectations can come in the way of dealing with reality. Because the expectations, we're just rowing when there are no oar and no boat. So like that, things just change sometimes completely. So at that time, either we can be resenting, why is there this gap between reality and expectation? Or we can start recalibrating. Okay, this is the reality, how can I deal with it? And as long as we are obsessing on this gap between reality and expectation,
that is the time we will be extremely resentful and we will not be able to deal with the situation at all. So the situation is bad, but actually as long as we are focusing on the gap between these two, the situation appears much worse than what it is. So for Ram, you can imagine the gap. At one moment he is going to be a prince and next moment he has to go into the forest with nothing. It's very difficult to imagine any bigger gap between the reality and the expectation. It's very difficult to deal with something like this. Very, very difficult. But it's a test of character. Can you recalibrate? So we all have expectations in life. But it's just human to have expectations. But the problem is when we become attached to our expectations. So psychological rigidity means that we just deal with our expectations only. Psychological flexibility means, okay, my mind was thinking like this, but now things have changed. So instead of focusing on the expectation, let me refocus. Focus on the reality and deal with it. So Ram demonstrates this psychological flexibility. Then when he goes to his mother, actually each one of these incidents is very moving. His interaction with his mother, his interaction with Sita, his interaction with his other citizens. So we'll discuss some of them briefly. Till what time is the class?
You can continue.
Okay. Don't set up unrealistic expectations. It's not okay. So then when he goes to Kaushalya, at that time, I'll not talk about Sita because that's a whole chapter itself, but I'll talk about Kaushalya and I'll talk about the citizens. So basically at that time, when he goes to Kaushalya and he tells his mother what has happened. His mother is aghast. She says, see, everybody has their own, the world is a tough place. Everybody is working through their own tragedies. No matter how successful they look, just scrape a little below the surface, you'll find that everybody has had some terrible things going wrong in life. Now when we see, sometimes we feel, how can a person be so bad? So actually speaking, if we see how bad life is for everyone, we shouldn't be shocked that people are so bad. We can be surprised why people are not worse. It's actually easy. It's easy to become resentful. It's easy to become revengeful. And it is a testimony to the resilience of the human spirit that bad things don't make people bad. Some people do become bad because of that. But there are many people, everybody, if they started claiming to be a victim, they can become vindictive, they can become vengeful. Everybody has reasons to complain in life. So now Kaushalya has her own sad story. Now she was the first queen, she's the eldest queen of Dashrath, but she somehow was neglected in favor of Kaikeyi. Now that was a very great sorrow for her. But somehow she lived with that. Then she thought that at that time for a king to have an heir is very important. But somehow although they tried, Dashrath could never, they just couldn't have any children. And she performed a lot of austerities and penances. They did yajnas. She prayed and prayed and then finally, after a long time, like a long dark night for her soul, after that, she had a son. And not just a son, but a son like Ram. Such a glorious son, the fulfillment of every dream of a mother. And just now she was thinking that now, after all that period, now Ram will become the prince, Ram will become the king. Every mother naturally dreams that her son will become glorious. Sometimes we are going through a long dark tunnel. And then we see a light at the end of the tunnel. We feel relief. And then we realize that that light is a train rushing at us.
Then we had to jump out of the way. What happened? So for Kaushalya, it was like that.
He thought, oh, I've got my son, he's the light in my dark life. And now that son has been sent to the forest. He says, how will I live without you? If so publicly the king has spurned me in favor of Kaikeyi, what will he do afterwards? Now that when Kaikeyi has the power by which she has her son as the king, you know, what will she do with me? She says, I can't live over here. Oh Ram, if you are going to the forest, please take me also with you to the forest. I cannot live here. Now Ram, generally what happens is when something bad happens to us and somebody has done something bad, so we want everyone to gang against that person. He's bad. Yes, so you agree with me? Because that person is bad. But Ram doesn't think in those terms at all. Ram says, oh mother, I was with my father and I could see that he was shattered by Kaikeyi betraying him in this way. Like when he said that, okay, he's a husband and she's a wife, sell you two boons. And he thought, okay, what will she ask? She'll ask for some jewelry, some this, some that. He never dreamt that she would ask for something like this. Like rip his heart apart. He told Kaikeyi also that, if at all you want Bharat to be the king, let him be the king. But don't send Ram away. I'll not be able to live without him. But so he said that the king has already experienced betrayal from his one queen. If at this time he experiences rejection from you, O mother, he will not survive. So he completely recasts things. Rather than when Kaikeyi is, the Kaushalya is seeing that Dashrath has done such a great wrong to me. He says Dashrath is not the wrongdoer. Dashrath is as much as a victim of the situation as you are. So generally, you know, we need to see the brother in the other. The brother in the other means that the other person is also a human being like us. Other person is also suffering like us. So then we won't become so vengeful, so vindictive. So what is Ram doing? Again, he's trying to maintain, make sure that bad things don't become worse. If mother also rejects and goes away, the whole royal household will break apart. So he's bringing things down. He says, oh, please be with my father. He needs you now more than ever before. And Kaushalya is very grief struck. But she remembers her duty. She says, oh Ram, how will I live for 14 years without you? See, mother says, oh mother, no, you just take care of father. In 14 years will just go like 14 days. And soon I'll be back with you. Now both of them know it's not true. But sometimes, you know, speaking a lie is the kind thing to do. Not that we want to keep the other person in the darkness, but we don't have to, by our words, put salt on somebody's wounds. So the wound is there, you know, it'll go like 14 days. He's basically decreasing the wounds. And then he has to go and pacify Sita. I'll skip that part. I'll come to the last part about the citizens and the courtiers. So when they are there, at that time, they are also, they're up in arms. This is, what kind of atrocity is this? They all love Ram. They all expected Ram to become the king, become the next king. So at that time, they say that this is a great injustice. And Ram, he recognizes, if they also rebel against the king, it will be a problem. So Ram says, what is the misfortune? What is the injustice? He says that, you know, for all of us who are householders, we are entangled in worldly life. We need the wisdom of the sages. And generally, we get it when we retire from household life and go to Vanaprastha. But he says, I am so fortunate that I have the opportunity to go to the forest and enrich myself with the wisdom of the sages, even now when I am young. And he says, an older brother is like a father. So the father's dream is that his son become greater than him. So he says, for me, if in my presence Bharat becomes a king, he says, it's a dream come true for me. So the king is able to honor his words, and he says, for me as a son, what greater joy can be there than to honor the word of my father? He says, I have the opportunity to honor the word of my father. I have the opportunity to fulfill the desire of my stepmother. I have the opportunity to see my younger brother enthroned as the king. I have the opportunity to enrich myself with wisdom from the sages. So I see only opportunity everywhere. What is the adversity? There are two kinds of people. Some people see solutions to all problems. And some people see problems with all solutions. So Ram, he's not just, just talking positive. He's living that positive reality. So by every situation, we can look at how bad it is, or we can look at what is the good in the situation. And bad things do happen in life. But when by our attitude, we can make the bad situation worse, or we can make it not so bad. What happens for, I'll conclude with this point, that for all of us, our mind, whatever is happening, our mind is passing a commentary about it. Say if we are attending a class, the mind is saying, this class is going too long now. Constantly, whatever is happening, our mind is passing a commentary. And sometimes the mind's commentary about a problem is a bigger problem than the problem itself. Like sometimes, say the weather is very bad, it's very hot. So some people, right from morning, it's like they are like a sound player just stuck on one audio. The weather is so hot, 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 the weather is so hot. And after some time, the heat is not as irritating as they're complaining. So, similarly, what happens is, when we have a problem, our mind is like that inner complainer. This is so bad, this is so bad, this is so bad, this is so bad. And in that way, the mind is complaining about the problem becomes a bigger problem than the problem itself. So we need to shift our mind somewhere else. And where do we shift the mind? See, our culture is primarily a culture of demanding rights. I have a right to this, I have a right to that, I have a right to that. And yes, rights are important. Now, rights can provide us freedom. But it is only responsibilities that can provide fulfillment. It is only when we take a responsibility, any situation you can look in life, you look back at your life and think of the happiest moments in your life. Yeah, now we might at a superficial level say, oh, I watched that movie, I watched that cricket match, it was so enjoyable. Okay, that's entertainment, that's stimulation. But some really deeply happy moments of our life are when we did something meaningful, we did something worthwhile. No, we were absorbed in something bigger than ourselves. And when through that we were able to achieve something, that is what brings fulfillment. That is what brings fulfillment. So when life treats us badly, we can keep agitating about our rights. This shouldn't have happened. Why is this happening? Why is this person treating me like this? And that doesn't help us. Because that's the reality is the way it is. We can't change it. But no matter how dreary the reality is, we can always take the responsibility to make it better. So claiming or demanding our rights, it doesn't make anything better. Now that doesn't mean we don't have rights. It just means that whether in a particular situation, demanding our rights is the right thing to do. If reality has changed and sometimes just bad things happen. So at that time, but this should not happen. Okay, yeah, it should not have happened, but it has happened. No, it shouldn't have happened. Well, it has happened. No, it shouldn't have happened. Okay, I agree it shouldn't have happened, but it has happened now. So sometimes demanding our rights is just not the right thing to do. So at that time, we can shift from rights to responsibility. The responsibility that at least, let me not make things worse. Let me see if I can make things better. And all of us, no matter how small, how insignificant we may be, we can take the responsibility to enrich our reality. We all can take the responsibility to enrich our reality. To enrich our reality means that we can make things better. So Ram, throughout his, he is considered the ideal human being for many glorious qualities, but here he's taking the responsibility to not make bad things worse. Taking the responsibility to make things as less bad as possible. So bad things just happen in life, and Ram demonstrates how to respond to that. We all can take the responsibility to enrich our reality. And if we decide to take that responsibility, Krishna consciousness can empower us in extraordinary ways. Krishna consciousness is also a choice. It's also a choice we have to take. Krishna consciousness is also a resource which we have, but we have to take that resource. Sometimes, while preaching, we may say, the only problem in the world is a lack of Krishna consciousness. But then we come back to the temple, we come back to our home, we come back to our community, and we say, the only problem in my life is this devotee. If only this person would not behave like this, my life would be so much better. Okay, yes. What happened to the only problem in the world is a lack of Krishna consciousness? That is for preaching. Not like that. Yes. Sometimes we can become very cynical even while practicing Krishna consciousness. No, devotees are like this only. People are like this only. This is like this. No. If we take the responsibility to enrich our reality, then Krishna is there to empower us. Krishna is there to empower us. So Krishna, but it is, if we don't take the responsibility to try to be Krishna conscious, then even Krishna can't help us. When Krishna can help us only when we choose to take his help. So we see in Prabhupada's life, so many things went wrong in his life. He wanted, if somebody wanted to write a story of how a person's life can be go terribly wrong, till the age of 65 or 69, you could say Prabhupada's life was like that. He tried to start a business, and it was for noble purpose. He said, through the business, I can sponsor and support my spiritual master's mission. But one time a fire burned up his place, another time a servant just robbed him, and overall his business didn't work. Then he tried to work with his god brothers and he tried to assist them, but they had a very narrow vision. He wanted to expand the magazine. He said, no, just keep it as it is. Then he tried to start his own magazine, and on the streets of Delhi he fainted in exhaustion. Nobody was ready to take the books. A cow ran into him and knocked him down. Then he started an organization, League of Devotees, in Jhansi, and the same people who were supporting his organization, they turned against him, and he had to leave from there. And finally, after great effort, he got an opportunity to go to America. And he just, when he was going to America, the only resource he had practically, materially speaking, was his body, and that body collapsed in two terrible heart attacks. He eventually got to America, and then he was living at a place, but he was not allowed to speak over there. So you just do keep the, don't speak, because the other person's philosophy was different. And he went to another place. But there, the janitor only stole his dictaphone and his typewriter. That is the only thing he had. Then he shifted to another place and there was another boy who was staying with him. And he seemed very enthusiastic. Prabhupada wrote a letter to India. He said he will become the first American Western Vaishnava, Western devotee. And then that boy, he took drugs, went mad and came to attack Prabhupada. And Prabhupada had to literally run away from that place. If somebody had to complain, Prabhupada had so many reasons to complain. Finally, he wanted to establish a center in America. And he actually got himself by writing letters to India, got a sponsor from India. Now, those of you who raise funds, you understand, even by going and meeting people, raising funds is difficult. And he, just by writing letter, he conveyed his earnestness and he got a sponsor from India to sponsor for a temple in America. But at that time, the Indian government was very strict about releasing foreign exchange. So then Prabhupada wrote to his godbrother. He first wrote back to the sponsor. He said, let's not make a big temple. He said, let's make a small center right now and eventually we'll build a temple. But for that person, it was a matter of religious pride. Said, I want to build a temple. He said, he has a proper spire, proper structure. Otherwise, he felt that what is the religious pride for him? So he said, no, we have to build a full temple. Then Prabhupada wrote to his godbrothers. And he said, one of his godbrothers had met the president of India, another had met the prime minister of India. He said, you just talk with them and let get them sanctioned. And they didn't even reply to him. So if Prabhupada had to become bitter, he had so many reasons. But through it all, he stayed faithful. Let me see how I can serve Krishna. And he just remained Krishna conscious and he tried to give Krishna consciousness to others. And what happened? Krishna in his time did astonishing things. Within 10 years, for the first, you could say almost 60, 70 years of Prabhupada's life, like one reversal after another, after another, after another. And generally, you know, people start with big ambitions in their life. Like somebody may say, I want to become the next president of America. Okay, with a small child, they may say, I want to become the president of America. As they grow up, okay, maybe not the president of America, at least, you know, I want to become the wealthiest person in my state. As they grow further in their life, life beats them down. And then, okay, by the time they graduate, if I get a job, it will be good.
So, life's adversities keep beating us down.
But Prabhupada, he never gave up his dreams. Because his dream was not for himself. And it was not based on himself. It was not for himself and it was not based on himself. It was for Krishna. It was based on his faith in Krishna. And so first 70 years of his life was like a dark life. Many dark chapters. But the last 10 had such a dazzling light that now all the previous 70 years become like an inspiring contrast. And so similarly, so Prabhupada's strength was that he was always conscious of the Lord. He didn't complain, he didn't become bitter. So what Lord Ram demonstrates, staying dutiful amidst distress, not complaining, not resenting. Prabhupada demonstrated that in his own life. Shri Prabhupada ki. So for all of us also, we can choose whether I am going to blame, that this is not right, why is this happening? Or I am going to take responsibility. If you take the responsibility, okay, in a small way, can I make things better? At least what can I do? Instead of blaming this person, thinking about this problem, let me think about Krishna. Let me pray to Krishna. Let me remember Krishna. And as we remember Krishna, we'll find that calmness and clarity will come into our lives. And generally, bad things happen to everyone in life. The insight that bhakti gives us is that greater than what faces us is what graces us. Greater than what faces us is what graces us. So Krishna and his mercy is there to grace us. But instead of looking at what is facing us and resenting, we look toward Krishna. That is the enduring lesson of the Ramayana. That instead of resenting situations, we take responsibility. And when we do that, we will find that we will discover by Krishna's grace strength that we did not know we had. And we will be able to create, we will become like a light in the darkness. And not alone we ourselves, we will be able to inspire others to light their candles. And thus we can, we may not be able to brighten the whole world, but we can brighten our world. We may not enrich the whole reality, whole world, but we can enrich our reality. And like Prabhupada's example shows, Krishna can empower people in extraordinary ways. Of course, we are not nowhere like Prabhupada. But the adventure of life is to discover how much good we can do by God's grace. If we take the responsibility of enriching our reality, how much we can enrich, that no one knows. Krishna can empower us to do things far greater than what we think ourselves capable of doing. And that is what we can pray to Lord Ram. That when bad things happen, instead of resenting, let us take responsibility. And thus, we can move forward in our life. I'll quickly summarize. I spoke today on the theme of Lord Ram's dutifulness amidst distress. I first talked about how the Lord has a contextual mission to establish Dharma and an eternal mission to give us his pastimes, by remembering which they can act as an inner home for us. An inner home where our thoughts and our consciousness gets rest and rejuvenation. And devotion has understanding God's greatness, which brings submission, and understanding his sweetness, which brings affection. So I talked about how the Lord does not act as God, he acts as a human being. And he exemplifies how we can act as a responsible human being. So Ram, for no fault of his, was exiled. But instead of railing at the injustice of it all, he tried to make things better. He diffused Kaikai's anger by, I would have done this willingly if you just told me. He diffused Lakshman's anger by shifting the blame from his father or his mother, or then Kaikai, to our destiny responsible. And he focused on his duty. So sometimes we feel life is so bad, but no matter how bad things are, we can make them worse. And that means we can make them better also. So it's just staying attached to our expectations, trying to row when there is no boat in the oars. We understand when our expectations are helping us to shape reality and when our expectations are coming in the way of reality. Then we have psychological flexibility to let go of expectations and deal with reality as it is. And for that, when he was dealing with Kaikai, with Kaushalya, he helped her see Dashrath not as a wrongdoer, but as also a co-wronged person. And that way, we have to see the brother in the other. See, others are also suffering like us. And it's easy to become resentful, but it only makes things worse. And lastly, I talked about how he saw positive and lived positive when talking about his citizens, He looked at opportunity everywhere. The mind's commentary about a problem sometimes makes the problem bigger. But if in that, they can stop the mind's commentary by not demanding rights, but taking up responsibility. How can I make the situation better? In whatever small way I can. And look at Prabhupada's life. He had so many reasons to be resentful. But Prabhupada remained purposeful in trying to serve Krishna. And Krishna, after 70 years of difficulty, gave 10 years of dazzling prosperity, spiritual prosperity. So for all of us also, if we take responsibility, then to enrich our reality, at least we can light our world. And who knows, Krishna can empower us to do much, much more. So let's conclude with a prayer to Lord Ram, the same prayer which we recited in the beginning. Shri Rama Chandra Shirsa Namami.
Shri Rama Chandra Shirsa Namami.
Shri Rama Chandra Vachasa Grunami.
Shri Rama Chandra Vachasa Grunami.
Shri Rama Chandra Manasa Smarami.
Shri Rama Chandra Manasa Smarami.
Shri Rama Chandra Sharanam Prapadye.
Shri Rama Chandra Sharanam Prapadye.
Shri Rama Chandra Bhagavan Ki.
Jai.
Shri Ram Navmi Maha Maha Utsav Ki.
Jai.
Shri La Prabhupada Ki.
Jai.
Gaur Bhaktarinda Ki.
Jai.
Gaur Premanande.
Jai.